1960s, and we ask you now to search the back of your memory for the name Leo the Lion Newman. Leo is the man who was just pushed back over toward the corner by referee Irish Jack Kennedy. Now, Leo was a mixture of junior heavyweight wrestler, manager, a man who tried his best to reach the top ranks of the wrestling world. When they called him the Lion, they did so because Leo was the kind of a man who truly admired lions and often tried to emulate them. Leo is famous for having made a trip from St. Louis to New Orleans on a raft down the Mississippi River with a lion as his only companion. The referee is Irish Jack Kennedy, and Kennedy is no longer alive. He was killed by an assailant's bullet in Dallas, and he was a fine heavyweight wrestler, and he switched to refereeing after his career as a wrestler had ended. And the man who is down and rising to his feet soon, I hope, because he is a great wrestler, and this bit of the film in which Leo the Lion Newman is assaulting him without any retaliation is not typical of the career of Tony Bergeron. Tony came from a great wrestling family. There were seven brothers. They were all massively strong. One of his brothers could carry a horse up a ladder and often did as a means of exhibiting his strength. But Leo the Lion Newman here, by counteracting the power of young Tony Bergeron, who was the youngest one of the family and probably the most dedicated wrestler, a man who had learned a great deal of wrestling skill and maintained a great deal of his speed and agility in spite of the fact that he was put through the same routine of strength exercises as his brothers by Papa Bergeron. By Tony here is taking an inordinate amount of punishment from Leo the Lion. Leo still lives in Imperial, Missouri. He is a man who is interested in the conservation of animals and is kind to animals and supports the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. But Leo could be as wild and as cruel when he stepped into the wrestling ring as any man who ever competed. And as he pounds Tony Bergeron down into the mat, the French-Canadian is on the rim of defeat, and if he is not able to bounce back against Leo, he is going to have his trouble. But we're just looking for the opportunity to say something nice about Tony Bergeron, because truly he deserves it, and he is capable and has proven, and did prove over his career, because he is no longer wrestling, with the fact that he could meet any man on an even basis. But he is here trying to escape from a tenacious Leo the Lion, who has one of the qualities of being a lion and is exhibiting it, and that is the stubbornness. And there now is the first opportunity that Tony Bergeron has had. But here is a man who is capable of outlifting Leo the Lion Newman, but it isn't always strength. It is the man who gets the jump. It is the man who is able to catch his breath quicker, and the man who is able to coordinate those muscles in a variety of ways, because the strength it takes to lift inanimate objects is not exactly the same as the strength that it takes to control somebody who is trying to knock your block off and somebody who is changing your balance and his balance constantly during a match like this. But this will show you what happens. Well, Leo the Lion had help on the outside of the ring, and whether it's going to do him any good or not, we will never know, as Tony Bergeron knocks their heads together. The gentleman in the high hat and the tails is Leo Voss. and Leo Voss as referee is carrying on a running argument with Mr. Moto and his partner, Duke Keamuka. Now, what you've got to remember is that we have transported you back into the 1950s to the Dallas Sportatorium, where the great series of Texas wrestling films were made at that particular time, and some of them are still in existence, and we have found them. Leo Voss is arguing with ring announcer George Preston, who has come into the ring to second Killer Kowalski, and he brought with him a pacifier of considerable size. The announcement is being made by George Preston in his own stentorian manner, and he is introducing this event. Now, I think he introduced the announcer who was to replace him because he couldn't do two jobs, and somehow memory fails me, and I am unable to place the name of the gentleman doing the announcing. But Killer Kowalski was, in these days, 275 pounds of magnificent muscle and mat machinery. He was, at that particular time, at the very, very height of his career. It was shortly after this that Kowalski decided that wrestling was not for him, and he adhered to his religious beliefs and went off to a monastery on the West Coast and became totally vegetarian. He dropped his weight from 275 pounds to 165 and almost died in the process. It took a long time before people were able to convince him that he could live with his religion and live at the same time, and he returned then to wrestling. The introductions being made, you saw Mr. Moto with the bow, and the pacing of Duke Keamuka was typical of him. George Preston, probably the biggest ham I ever knew, but right now he is receiving the plaudits of the assemblage at the Sportatorium. And here is the magnificent figure of Killer Kowalski. Now, this was the time before he was responsible for his own loss of weight. The gentleman you saw push his way into the picture at that particular time was the former Zebra Kid, George Bolus, another great name in wrestling back in the 1950s. And all this argument that's taking place preceding this battle, the anger of Charlie Moto against the former announcer, George Preston, white gloves, top hat, and tails. Now, you can't get more elegant than this in the wrestling field. But George Bolus has come into the ring to do some challenging, and he is being introduced. The 350-pound Greek star is adding more problems to the one that faces Killer Kowalski anyway, and this match has not yet gotten underway, but Bolus is bellowing, and Bolus is trying to make his presence felt, and he has done it. And here is George Bolus, the bellicose Greek, who is clubbing Killer Kowalski. But Kowalski is a man of tremendous strength, a man who now operates a wrestling school, who is a professional photographer, who has a drop kicker at the weight of 275 pounds, and who is trying to teach George Bolus a lesson by introducing him to the turnbuckle of the ring. And Bolus, trying to protect himself with his hand there, did not have total luck. But this leaves Kowalski then ready to turn and to get this match underway, as he is set to face Mr. Moto and Duke Keamuka. But there is supposed to be one man in the ring, and he had guaranteed to beat both of them. But right now, our time is about up, and we may never find out just exactly how this ended.
They're one of nature's
big Irish fist of his, and pounds Bulldog Pletchus down to the canvas. McShane, a real junior heavyweight, and a man who has established himself as world champion over the years in several respects, now finds that he has been separated by a man who had a reputation for being tough. That was Don Evans, who is the referee in this particular battle that took place in Dallas, and most certainly delighted Dallas fans back in the 1950s. McShane at this time was world's junior heavyweight champion, but campaigned not only in the junior heavyweight division, but in among the heavyweights who, like Bulldog Pletches, who came from Omaha, Nebraska, and was started in wrestling by the famous Dusick brothers. Bulldog is the kind of a guy who learned the Dusick tricks well and has convinced McShane right now that he learned it well. But Don Evans, who now in the 1980s lives on a farm in upper New York State and probably has memories of the days that he wrestled here in Texas, because anybody who has faced tough competition in the state of Texas always has a special niche of memory that they never, never let diminish. So the Bulldog, Pletches, on the receiving end now as McShane winds up and pitches, and Bulldog catches. That was inevitable. That's one of the reasons why his face got to look the way it does, and that is that fellows like McShane found great pleasure in being able to pound it whenever it was possible. Now, McShane is a man who has left his indelible mark on wrestling, and you're looking on the outside of the ring. You see a strange apparition. That happens to be Iron Mike DiBiase, who managed the Bulldog, who did all of the Bulldog's talking, who had the Bulldog as a tag team partner. And in this particular match, the manager or the handler or whatever you want to call Iron Mike as in his relationship with Bulldog, because they were tag team partners also, one of the stipulations was that Iron Mike was to wear a straitjacket if indeed he was to be at ringside at all. So you can see that they had a pretty good idea of what Iron Mike was capable of doing. Iron Mike is a man who ended his wrestling career in Texas. He died in the ring in Amarillo when he wrestled a huge individual known as Man Mountain Mike, and who literally fell on Iron Mike and brought about his death in the ring. So the Bulldog being urged on by Iron Mike DiBiase, and I might also point out that Iron Mike's son, Ted DiBiase, is wrestling now in the 1980s and doing extremely well, too. So McShane, unaccustomed to having fans rooting for him, gets inspired by the noise of the crowd and inspired by the opportunity to know that he's just a handsome young fellow after all. McShane, as many of you know, is still involved in wrestling in Texas. He referees wrestling matches regularly in Houston. And there are fans who sometimes come up and say, did Danny McShane ever wrestle? Well, here's the answer. Danny McShane was once the king of the hill in the lightweight division, rather the light heavyweight division. He came up from the middleweight division into the light heavyweight division and then the junior heavyweight division and held the world's title in each of them. And he, in some people's minds, he is the perennial tough guy because of his ability to give and to take. He is also the man who invented the idea of coming into the ring dressed like a peacock, and has long been copied because of his strutting antics in the ring. But few have been able to copy his tremendous ability to pound an opponent into senselessness. So, a little nostalgia on the best of Texas wrestling. And